Testing. Is this working?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, great. Okay, so hi everyone. My name is Tyler. I run a small aerospace startup called Star Space. Just a quick show of hands here. How many people have worked with like small satellites or aerospace? Okay. Well then, this is a fresh audience. Hopefully we have a lot of exciting things to share with you guys. So at Star, we build a constellation of small satellites that aim to build sort of an AT&T for space, so a telco for space. Why are we doing this, right? Space is changing. So launch vehicles, I'm not sure if you guys are familiar, but in the rocket business, there's like 30 new companies building rockets for like pennies on the dollar. They're building them a lot smaller and with techniques of mass manufacturing that help bring the cost to access orbit way down. Whereas before you would think of space as something like, well, that's probably something governments or like Boeing or Raytheon work on, right? Well, now it's about, it's still expensive, but just so that you guys know, it's like $26,000 per kilogram to get to orbit. And that is expensive, but when you consider sort of the direction that it's going in, which will be just a few thousand dollars per kilogram, and you look at the miniaturization of electronics, you start to see a relationship there where like, wow, there's a fundamental change of economics happening in the space industry. So, and so it has. This has catalyzed a whole new generation of space startups like Planet and Spire, a whole slew of small companies that are capturing this new market opportunity. And this is enabling us to observe Earth from like sub-meter precision. So, and that's allowing things like better agriculture, improved logistics, asset tracking, disaster recovery, all basically every vertical of your life is being changed by what's capable now in space. I mean, think about it. People have, you know, gotten married and gone to war based on what the weather has said. So it really affects every, you know, every area of your life. By the way, if anybody has like questions and stuff, I kind of want to make this dynamic, and especially like once I hand off the technical side to Fabio, please chime in. But if anybody has any questions or anything to say about space, then just jump in. All right. But despite all this excitement about new space and rockets being cheaper and satellites miniaturizing just as our cell phones have, there's a problem, right? Which is that communicating with your satellite is really hard. You can't like plug an Ethernet jack with your satellite. It doesn't work that way. So, and the key to this new space revolution is they launch them at far lower orbits. In other words, they launch them a lot closer to Earth, only about, you know, 400 to 500 kilometer altitude, as opposed to the 40,000 kilometer altitude they were done in previous orbits. Now this has a problem. Your satellite is going about 8 kilometers a second. It's a few times faster than a bullet. So it's really hard to track the satellite, and it's hard to establish a high bandwidth link with your satellite. What Star is doing is we're launching satellites alongside them to act as cell phone towers. You do a cross-link with our satellites, and then we figure out all the logistics of getting that data back down. So you can just focus on what you're trying to do, right? Which would be like taking pictures of Earth or doing IoT connectivity and things like that. You link that to our backhaul, and then we figure out the rest. Just to digress here for a second, because this is like a workshop sort of setting. It's interesting to observe that it feels a lot like the internet did in the early like 90s, even early 2000s, right? Whereas if you wanted to do a startup, what did you have to do? Well, holy cow, well, let me hire an IT person, let me buy like a rack, let me buy some server blades, let me click in the RAM, let me click in the CPU, I'd like shop for good motherboard deals and negotiate with your ISP and hook up an Ethernet jack and all these kinds of things, right? Whereas now, like, look at what Uber or Airbnb and all these big guys are doing, right? You just spin up a server in AWS, just click a button and, hey, there's a server. We want to make it that easy for people to do operations in space. So that's Stara, that's what we're trying to do. Here we have Fabio Alzano, who's our lead engineer.
Sorry, but just to make sure I understand, are you providing a communications network for other people's satellites, or are you providing the satellites themselves for people to use?
More the former, but technically the latter is true too. So all we're doing is just creating a network in space. So you just connect your satellite to ours, and now you can downlink as much data as you'd like. We have sort of like, we've toured around with the potential of expanding our market capabilities to offering sandboxing and stuff like that to our satellites, but just from a commercial standpoint, we're not sure that the business is really there. So I'm excited to share that we'll be launching a few satellites up in a few months, so you can imagine we're all like, everything is super crazy right now. We don't have a lot of sleep, but we're super excited to be working on this. And here we have Fabio Waisano, who's going to tell you more about the technical details.
All right.
It'll take a minute just to set things up.
Yep.
Hey, Joy. All right.
Thanks.
I'll leave it in your hands, Fabio.
All right.
Here's the microphone.
That's one of my books.
Stop. Is it really?
You like it?
No, I wish. It's pretty much cool. My soldier's not that good.
1, 2, 1, 2. So, NuttX in space. Just 1 second more, please.
Yeah.
I brought up something here. Let's see if it works.
Please. Oh yeah, I got you. Here. Oh, I see that's already scratched you, Fabio.
Yeah.
You good?
Yeah.
All right.
All right. Okay, so let's talk about NuttX in space, the practical implementation. And so this is a pocketQube satellite application. PocketQube is a new format. It's teeny. It's very small kind of. It's a very small kind of satellite. Okay, we are talking about something of this dimension, more or less. Okay, our satellite is 3P. P is the dimension unit we work with, and 3P means something like 15 centimeters long, okay? 15 centimeter by 5 by 5, yeah? Okay, so this is not working. Sorry, guys.
It's the laws of technical demos. Yeah.
It's not working. Okay.
All the best demos.
So, today's topics. Let's have an overview of our platform, why we are using NuttX, what actually is doing NuttX, our challenges, and our building system. Okay, so our platform. Let's introduce before our platform. So we are working with this pocketQube standard for factor. It will be an heterogeneous system. It's because it's composed by Linux and a real-time operating system. So there will be an application, a processor, and a real-time operating system. Both of them, we split the duties. Application system, for instance, is very good for routing and authentication of packets coming from Earth, and compression and encryption. And a real-time operating system is for sensoring, actuators, and so on. So, we use the automotive standards for design the electronic circuits. This pocketQube standard is quite new, so we had also to make it cheaper, because it's very important, it has to be cheap, because if it's cheap, we do the difference in space. So, there is no previous experience, but, let's say, NASA, SpaceX, working on this size format, but the automotive standards are the strictest standards in the market to allow you to build safe electronics. Okay, It's not just layout, the PCB layout, it's also components. It's another completely another standard. They have strict requirements, and it fits perfectly our purposes. So our platform has to be innovative. So we were looking for, in the past months, new ideas to put inside the machine. It's a very little machine, and it's compressed of technology. There is an attitude control system that, for instance, adjusts the state, the attitude and the state in the space, because there is no gravity. So you have to orient the antennas to the earth, and you have to make sure they will stay steady in place. Yeah. So for that reason, there is a system, it's called ABCS, and it's used for the attitude control. Okay. And for doing that, we are also looking for new ideas. Mm. If we pack enough innovation in this platform, eventually we are going to win, because that's the key. It has to be cheapest, very cheap, and also innovative. So cheapest as possible, and also easy to assembly and efficient to test. Okay, so overview of the system. So let's.
Yeah, where's your point?
Yeah.
Nice.
So this is the central Earth. There is an NXP INX RT 1062 with NuttX on it. Okay, this is the EMS, Electronic Management System. This is very important block, because it takes care of, for example, the deploy. After the launch from the rocket, there will be the deploy phase. And deploy means taking care of enabling the other subsystem. And it's an high risk, it's critical. If something gets wrong there, we lose the satellite, and maybe forever. Okay, so it's very important we do this properly, and we take the enough care to prepare the deploy phase. Okay, so we have the Earth here, as you see. Then there is the ABCS, attitude determination control system. Inside this you have an IMU, several sensors, all packed together. There are also actuators. I don't know if you are practice with a system in space of this kind, but there are magnetometers, static. Sometimes there are static magnet, static magnet. Just passive magnet.
Yeah,
yeah, to stabilize the attitude. Sometimes they are active, so we apply electricity on electromagnet to orient the state of the satellite. And there are also wheels that create momentum, okay, to recover from a bad, because maybe the satellite is banking, so there is a reaction wheel that physically is creating momentum. This wheel begin to run, to stop the motion, to stop that momentum that is turning, is banking the satellite. Okay, okay, and we are doing this in a completely different way. Yeah, we are not using wheels. We are using piezo ceramic pulsing. Okay, pulsing and giving another kind of momentum. Okay, this is completely new technology. It's a new idea. You are the first to listen to this ever. And let's see what's happening. Okay, about the power supply. This is another critical section, because if this fail, we lose the satellite again. So we wanted to use an SPC coming from the automotive market, system based chip, with a fail-safe state machine core. This model is quite new. It's still some of them are still in developing. We are here NXP people, so maybe later you can share a word about this. Okay, so it's connected with our lithium batteries and supercapacitors. So this is also another innovation, supercapacitors. These allow us to reduce the weight from batteries. Okay? So this satellite could be very expensive if you do it wrongly. Because maybe you are going to put a lot of batteries because you have a lot of RF modules inside. So I was trying to optimize this subsystem, so I introduced the supercapacitor. Supercapacitor will recharge during the light orbit, and we will try to squeeze them as much as we can to provide energy for the RF. Then we have solar panels and also another innovation, energy harvesting. Okay, space environment is quite unique because there is a large range of temperature ranges. Okay, you go down 100 degrees below zero and you go up. Okay, actually it's minus 40, usually minus 40 below zero and plus 100 can be. Yeah, so why we don't use Peltier module to absorb, to gather that difference, that gap of in temperature and convert it in energy? Okay, so we wanted all to implement this. So all these countermeasure about power consumption is to reduce the weight of the batteries. It's really important because battery is the element that is more weighty element, so it's very expensive. Yeah, because you heard before, it's around 30 key per kilogram. So if you reduce the battery, maybe you save some money, yeah? Okay, so let's continue briefly. So we have the OBC, onboard computer. This is doing the routing of packet, is doing the compression, the encryption, and is connecting directly with the RF module for the telemetry. And the other module for the services that we are selling to our customers. Okay, there is the reason. Another interesting block is the firmware over the air orbit, maybe, or space. Yeah, but that is another MCU that is receiving from the ground control station firmware updates. Usually, user line piece of code to improve, to solve maybe future issue that we and we realize. This is also another innovation because allow us to use the protected build and get the most of it. Yeah. So let's see. Let's continue. Okay. Let's see. Here you have a video. It's flashing. I'm sorry, this is because my laptop, okay? Anyway, this is a 3D model representation. You see here the solar panels providing energy to the spacecraft. The main body is in aluminum. So imagine this small like this, is 15 centimeters, okay? And this is 5, 5, 5, 15, okay? There are, our design is very modular. Now it will stop and I will show you the, I will talk a little bit about our modules. And sorry, the video is so flashy. Yeah, it's because my laptop. Okay, so there is a upper level of electronics and a lower level, okay? There are redundant connections, so for each buses there is a redundant connector. In case one gets broken, there is the other. Mm-hmm. And those are for data bus. So we have RF at the center, shielded by two metal parts. This block contains the main RF module. This is a cylinder that will develop a conus to give us the horn antenna typology. Okay. So imagine the horn antenna is like a conus inside the cylinder. Once in space, it gets deployed, so it gets released and it will open. Yeah. This guy is working around, we are still determining it, he's working higher than 50 gigahertz, okay? Because we want real high bandwidth, so quite enough high frequency. So, RF, main RF module, here we have the power supply that right now for laboratory purpose, we have just a LTO transforming voltages in usual 3.3 volts and 1.8 volts for the microcontrollers. Then here we have the switchers for the deploy, and here we will have the main MCU with NuttX, and this one is the Linux OBC and sensors. We have also a small PCB for sensors. Okay, let's continue. Okay, this is the aluminum case, picture of it, so you can realize better what we are talking about. Okay, completely open. So, main RF module goes here, the other modules on top, and the other two on the bottom. Okay? Alright. Okay, here you see a few modules, RF. This is for designed for laboratory purposes, so at the moment, as demonstration platform, is providing a Wi-Fi signal, okay? Not that 50 GHz signal. So it's designed for dual diversity Wi-Fi antenna. But then we have the power supply module. This is the sensor. Sensors include IMU, light sensor. Light sensor is useful to understand where is the sun. So we can understand the orientation. Yeah? Okay, let's continue. So why NuttX?
So,
yeah.
Maybe it's slightly off topic, but as far as I know, radiation is a concern in space.
Yeah, sometimes. But also, I spent maybe 2 months in that, and the pioneer of as provider of hard radiation hardened solution is Texas Instruments at the moment. So I was evaluating MCU from them, but then I realized also there is a certain point of market hype on that, because anybody's moving in that direction, just Texas Instruments. I'm sure that it's something real, the radiation problem is something real, but for that reason I also implementing redundancy in the connectors, and I'm using a fail-safe state machine SBC. So in case there is a failure, maybe we can recover better. And our fleet is composed by 150 satellites. Okay, there is a certain point of redundancy. So if we lose for 1, 2, 3 minutes the time of rebooting, okay, a satellite, maybe we can absorb a certain amount of risk. Yeah, and so we have to evaluate the cons and the pro of, okay, we are going with a hardening solution, completely hardening, super expensive, because in that case we have to harden everything, not just the MCU. So it's special, super special, maybe 60,000, 100,000 euro just for one satellite. Yeah. Or we want maybe risk, accept a little bit of risk, and maybe put in orbit 2, 3, 4 maybe more spare satellites, and manage the risk with the cheaper electronics. So we are choosing this way, yeah? Yeah, but that is a real issue. But also there is a little bit of hype on market, yeah. I spent 2 months on that. So we evaluated several real-time operating systems. Okay, free RTOS, everybody knows, TSAN RT, commercial. Okay, that is not an I, it should be an I. Kiwi OS, and briefly others, Zephyr, just briefly, yeah? And in the end, we choose NuttX. Okay, because it's up for many platforms. There are so many platforms, so that means also different brain. different brain because every platform has got its specific requirement. And so there are different way to think the things. So we have to diversificate. This is a better management of the risk. So if we are analyzing the communities, there are different kind of style of people, is better because they react differently. They react differently to the problems. And maybe if we have a problem, maybe we can list them: one guy from Asia, one guy from United States, and one guy from Europe. All those people with different brains, and maybe in the end there is a better solution. Okay. So this is also a plus for NuttX supporting so many architectures. Yeah? In our point of view, it's very helpful. There is the protected build. So I would like to spend 1 minute, please, if you allow me, because this is really important for us. So the protected build allows us to have a separate environment to run our user land. Okay? So we have, for instance, our way to manage the ADCS, the attitude control, okay? But maybe we realize we could do it better, because after 100 orbits, we see, okay, we are out of phase of 5 degrees. Why that? Maybe it's because this. Okay, so upload. Firmware over the year, this is a fix, and let's try. So there is a kernel space doing stuff separately, as much as we can, of course, and the user space. So our application stuff, all the application is running in the user space. And this is provided by the protected build, okay? A very good feature of NuttX, so we are there for this reason, yeah? Then there is POSIX, so we can import a lot of code from Unix board. And this is also very good because there are a lot of developers behind that. You know, when you are in space, you always try to be more as safest as possible. This is the key, as safe as possible. Because when you move and you do a failed step, you lose 1 million. Or how much? Maybe you can lose, okay, we broken up 5, 6 satellites. Okay, you lose how much? 500 euro, maybe, or 400 euro, maybe higher.
Yeah,
okay.
It'll be higher.
Yeah, so imagine. It's better you don't stay at the top with the technology, you stay a little bit behind, and this is very common in space, using very ancient, very old microcontroller. It's the case of the Mars Pathfinder. It was using the 85C... Dave, you are an expert on that, no? The
8051?
Yeah, yeah. 8085, I think, 80, I don't remember. 8051?
8051, maybe.
Like shingle chip or 8051. Yeah, and all the people were asking, why are you using so old technology? Because it's a proven technology.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's proven, it's very basic, we know where it is at all the times. Okay, you are safe. Okay. So we are not going to lose $10 million. Okay. So proven reliability. It's also one of the most active open source because the number of commits. Yeah. So NuttX. There was a presentation from a journalist evaluating several operating system, and NuttX is one of the top with the highest number of commits. The community support is very good. Usually when you have a problem, same day you receive an answer, and maybe an improvement the day after. And so it's very good. Okay, what is doing NuttX? Okay, there are two phases. There is a phase just after the deploy from the rocket. That's critical, super critical. If we fail them, we lose the satellite. And the second phase is normal mission duties, okay? So let's give a look at them to understand a little bit better. So after satellite deploy, what's happened? It's time to the panels deploy. We have to open them. So there is a release mechanism. You have to drive it. Hmm? you have to enable the power supply for the subsystems. So we also have to turn on the OBC with Linux. You have to understand that when you launch a satellite, everything is down. Okay? And you have to be very careful, because if the power sequence doesn't work, maybe you could be surprising that the turning on in an electronic is the most difficult thing. Yeah, because if you fail that, it will not turn on, so you lose the satellite, okay? So it's very critical. And for this reason, we are providing a redundancy, even for turning on. So there are double the MOSFETs. In case one is broken, there is the other MOSFET turning on the power bus. And it has to enable the RF modules, yeah? And in the end, after all this, it will send the LI signal to the GGS, ground control station, yeah? So during the mission, what we have? During the mission, NuttX will monitor the current consumption. There are sensors for that, analog sensors. And there are more than one, there are many. Maybe 10, from 10 to 15. Because everything in space is monitored, yeah? So ADCS is a big part. There is a sensor reading. So there is this IMU, there is the light sensor, and some other sensor to understand the attitude of the spacecraft. And then the same system provide the driving for the actuators. Okay, actuators, our piezo ceramic idea, pulsing, and giving a momentum to stabilize or correct wrong position in space. Then there is the temperature monitoring, because it's crazy. Temperature in space, everything is crazy in space. There is no gravity, so you also have to think that when you solder, maybe you solder, there is a bubble of air, because it's zero gravity, it will expand. Maybe the PCB will break up. So you have to put the PCB during the mass production. You have to also scan with the X-ray the PCB board to understand the quality of the soldering. Yeah, and then NuttX will do the watchdog for the Linux OBC to make sure that it's always on in case it will reboot. And it will send telemetry about the status together with the Linux OBC onboard computer. Challenges. Mm-hmm. Okay, we were talking about this earlier. Again, correct prioritization. Sorry, it's very difficult for me. Correct prioritization of tasks. Yeah. There was a case, I also read an email about the Mars Pathfinder. They failed on this. Big mess. Yeah. So, another time in space, this is a real important point. This is a real challenge. We have to make sure our software code will correct prioritize the tasks. Yeah. Then we have to provide an user land in protected environment has to be safe. Yeah, has to be safe. We have to make sure there is no the condition Gregory was explaining earlier, that some process maybe escalate and distort the kernel space. So there we will need a truthful inspection of what we are doing. The lowest power consumption, because firmware can improve or degrade the power consumption. And power consumption in space is so much important. Because you reduce the battery, if you reduce the battery, you reduce the weight and you save money. But a lot of money. Yeah, you heard before. A lot of money is lost in weight. So lowest power consumption means also that is a safer platform, because everything gets controlled. Yeah? The control in space is important. It's very important, because get to know the state of the hardware every time, what is doing, what is not, why, even the why. Yeah. So lowest power consumption, and we have also to develop new drivers. Okay. I'm sorry, I'm getting longer, okay? I'm close to the end. So, correct prioritization of tasks. It's very hard for me. Yeah, you heard about that, the case of Mars pathfinding the spacecraft. So that's the link, that was an email in the NuttX mailing list and mentioning it. And is a case indicating the problem. So we will take care about that. Again, protected build. So we are going to separate the user land from the kernel space. This will allow us to provide the FOTA capabilities, firmware over the air, firmware over the space or orbit. We will invent a new word for that. Yeah. So this directly increase the recovery capabilities. Okay. So thank you, NuttX, to provide us the protected build. Increase recovery capabilities. Continuous optimization. We realize that something is not perfect as we want. So we can upload and maybe fix it. Yeah? So in the end, what we obtain, more robust runtime. Yeah? Nice.
Question.
Yeah.
When you talk about the firmware over
the air,
whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
are you then talking about actually just updating the various applications that you're running?
Yeah, the user land, as much as we can, yeah.
Okay, so but the kernel you're leaving untouched?
Untouched.
Okay.
Once it's defined in space, we have to be safe. So once it's defined something that we know that is a certain point, we are not going to touch it anymore.
Okay.
Yeah, because even touch it, you don't know. Maybe you are introducing a bug, okay? And we don't want that.
Okay.
So kernel, once it's defined, untouchable. Yeah. Dave.
So the OTA or not A, or is it any, but the issues with like irradiation and muons hitting the device, if you upload a file to a file system and then it gets corrupted on the file system,
yeah, could
it
be.
Seems like you need a real robust mechanism for verifying the image, and then programming the image is
yeah.
dangerous.
It yeah, sure.
Like, yeah.
Sure. So we have an MCU for that, a separating MCU from the LPC series. Okay. It's providing that capability. So it's an intermediate MCU that will take the firmware update from the GCS, verify we are just doing MD5. MD5, I think is enough. MD5 is a hashing algorithm to check a blob if it corresponds to the original or not. Okay, and we check it and then we install it. Yeah, but it's a real issue. Yeah.
Yeah, so I just wonder how you sleep at night. Maybe
ask to Tyler that he has got all the responsibility on the shoulder.
Question. Do you have redundancy also for the NuttX part?
No. No. There is no redundancy because, okay, we do that as much as we can, but also we can't over redundancy because we lose the point of getting the cheapest possible machine. So we have to balance. Pro and cons. Okay, for the power part, for instance, we are not going with the redundant power supply. We said, okay, maybe with a fail-safe state machine, SBC is enough. Okay, because we will know the state in case there is something wrong. Okay, and that is the kind of compromise that we need to look in for, because you can't just put everything there. And for instance, I was evaluating the dual-step technology from Texas Instruments a lot, maybe 2 months.
Yeah.
People chased it for me, several boards to understand that. But then in the end, I think it's too much. We need to keep easy and simple the hardware, I think. Maybe I'm wrong, I hope so, not. But you have to choose some time. You have to choose where to go.
Just to touch on that a little bit.
Yes, please.
From a design standpoint, so these spacecrafts are only meant to be in orbit about 16 to 18 months. We may in the future do some orbit keeping to keep them up in space longer, but So when you're looking at those time frames, and also we're not quite outside of the Earth's magnetic sphere, so we don't deal with radiation as intensely as you would if you're all the way in geostationary orbit. The trade-off analysis turns out, like, I hear a lot of sort of concern around the radiation and stuff, and there certainly is stuff to be concerned about, right? Like, it's no joke. But if you do clever shielding in the way that you're designing, sort of like if you put the random access memory closer to the center of the board where they're shielded around the batteries, and so a combination of clever design and system requirements, which is that this thing won't be in orbit for more than about 2 years, it kind of works out so that we're taking calculated risks. As Harvey said, we may be wrong, but we'll learn about that in orbit. Like, if we launch we're going to have about, you know, 3 or 4 satellites going up before the end of the year, and we notice that they just keep having this issue, then we'll design them. But this is sort of like a continuous deployment of satellites, as opposed to the traditional, let's spend 7 years designing a spacecraft that's going to geostationary.
Yeah, but the microcontroller is not really designed for a delta of 150 degrees. And you will have every day.
Yep. Well, 150 degrees Celsius or something?
We are using automotive standard for that.
Yep. We
are using automotive standard for that. Automotive microcontroller are designed to be up to 125 degrees and working perfectly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And even below zero, up to minus 40, perfectly. That's why we are implementing automotive standards. Yeah, because they are very strict. So I understand you. There are a long list of concerns, and we have to balance in the end. We have to accept some risk and see what we have. Please, other.
I was curious on the over the air updates if you're using any of the file system sharing capability in NuttX. So, or are you just reprogramming that?
Reprogramming. Yeah.
Did you look at? It sounds interesting to me to have this whatever it was called, merge file system.
Union file system. Yeah, I heard before also, but at the moment we are just reprogramming. Okay, we will consider the union file system later when we have the first data to work on and understand better what is going on in orbit and how easy it is. And in case we have, maybe we can introduce for the next models the union file system, or we will see that. It's also introducing another layer, underneath layer, and in space we want to keep the things very easy, blocked, hardened, as much as we can. Yes, please.
What kinds of things can you test in terms of system operation on the ground? And what kinds of things will you not be able to test until it's up there?
Okay. Yeah, we will do extensive tests in our laboratories. One is, for instance, testing the hardware inside a vacuum pump to study the degassing of every material. Because in space, zero gravity, you expect that the plastic, even the plastic, will degas. So if we lose material. You know? So we are going to put our system inside a vacuum with high vacuum pressure, no? Negative pressure, and see. And there are other tests also. There is a vibration test, to simulate the rocket launch. And what else? High temperature in the oven, up to 100, 120 degrees, and freezing condition,
Yeah, the three big tests are TVAC, vibration, and radiation. Unfortunately, there's a whole lot that you can't test.
Yeah,
that's I'm interested in knowing what you won't be able to test for.
Imagine the RF link, right?
The RF link we can test.
You can test on the ground, but you're not going to be able to test the obvious distance and the issue.
That's
space, the whole space thing.
That's right. Yeah. So what we're doing right now is we're simply attenuating all the antennas and stuff to the dBs that the link budget indicates will be relative to the distance, but no, there's a whole slew of things that we. It's also a cost trade-off, right? Like, do we buy this $5 million machine, or do we launch this in space for $1 million and see?
Yes. Yeah. There also depends by the way you design the hardware. For instance, if you have a connector, you know, it's bringing a lot of cores. and it's passing over there, and there is a time wrap keeping in place, you will do specific tests on that. Because maybe orienting the spacecraft on the y-axis, because you know that the tension, so depends also how you design that. And you will be looking for ideas how to test, to do proper testing of the hardware before putting in space. Yeah. So I go fast. Any other? Sorry. Yeah, please.
If you cannot do the testing on the hardware, what can you do in simulation up front? Are you using simulation to, let's say, model this whole thing?
Up to a certain point. Okay. In space, we want to do a real test always. That is also another standard, that they do test for everything. When you have a launch, for instance, that means they spent 1,000 hours testing in several conditions, whatever test you can imagine, they did that. Testing and not simulating. That is the way in space. Simulating, for instance, you can simulate the orchestration of the fleet in orbit. Okay, you can, Anthony, you are an expert in this. So orchestration of many satellite in orbit, understand the way to do it more efficient. Yeah, that will be a mathematical simulation, of course. Yeah, but on the hardware, we prefer real smashing on the ground with a hammer. Yeah. Okay. Sorry, I'm late. So, lowest possible power consumption. This is a critical feature. So let's wait, it's cheaper to launch. Okay, if we are able to have a bigger budget, we can pack more electronics. So we can add sensor, we can add more stuff in it. But if you are not very good in power optimization, power consumption optimization, we just work with what we have. So if we have 1,000 milliampere hours, it's dead. So you can't pack infinite number of sensors. So we have to be careful about obtaining the lowest possible power consumption. So we can also increase the payload. Yeah, safer, because it's safer. When you have circuitry safer, and the copper tracks are thin, so it's clean. Dave, you're an expert in this, in the PCB layout. So when you have a low power consumption, you're also safer. Yeah? OK.
Small question, just.
Yeah, please.
What is the power consumption?
Pardon? What is the?
Power consumption.
Power consumption. OK. Actually, we are working, we think we are at 20 ampere maximum, OK? Because we have a RF module that its power consumption is a lot. We are talking about the 70 GHz and high bandwidth module. Then there is the Linux computer around 350 milliampere. NuttX will be not more than 150 milliampere maximum. And then all the other sensors and we will have some loss, we will have some loss, but we are dealing on that. Yeah, please.
Do you also think about, in your architecture, about sleeping mechanisms to bring things down, to save power?
Yeah. Okay. There is a moment under the orbit that is the satellite is out of view. So there is no exchange of information and telemetry with the ground station. Yeah, that part we will turn off as much as we can of the system. The fleet is a big mesh network. So in case one satellite is not enough, there is another helping him or sharing or passing through the communication, the data, then going down to the Earth. Yeah, so. As much as we can, we will keep them off. And for that, we will use orbit orchestration, because it will provide the right moment when the right decision policy. Okay. And also inside the satellite, there are system, there are logics to keep down the subsystem when they are unused. Yeah, yeah. Some other?
I think we better move on.
Yeah. Sorry. Okay. So we will try to submit the patches for the approval. Okay. Hopefully, they will end in the NuttX mainstream, so we can expose new code to the NuttX community. So this we will achieve a lot more of testing. Yeah.
You might just want to skip over
that. Yeah, we will skip that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Right. Our testing system. This is BuildBot, and it's an introduction. How we are automating the building and the testing. There is an hardware always there to building automatically and test the hardware and report in case there is a problem. Yeah. So any question? Any more question?
I think it would be useful to continue that BuildBot discussion later, maybe tomorrow.
Yeah.
Because I think that is one of the things that has come up several times on the mailing list about.
Yeah.
What can we do to be blunt, to make Greg's life easier in terms of doing regression testing and integration tests.
Yeah.
But I think we probably do need to defer it until tomorrow now, because I'm watching the timescale slowly slide out the window. So
this is so nice.
Be careful.
Yeah, this is so nice. The local worker can be even a Raspberry Pi, and you can build NuttX with a recipe. You have a book full of recipe, depending on your taste. You choose a recipe, and your Raspberry Pi will build NuttX, and then you will flash it via USB. And then you can also add another electronic to automatically test the power consumption, the levels, the bus, and report. Because there is a problem, you can report. This is so nice.
We'll try and find some time for this tomorrow, I think, if we possibly can, because I think this is really important. But do we have just one or two questions, and then we move along to the next presentation? I think we've covered a lot of stuff already, so we'll just do two questions. But one just here.
Just one quick question relating to the satellite. You said you worked by your years of assumption for the correction of the angular momentum. What do you think is the biggest advantage? Comparing to reaction wheels?
Okay. Yeah, reaction wheel, the problem is power hungry. Because, power supply, power budget, reducing the power budget is so important. So we are totally oriented in make this platform as much as innovative we can. So that idea is our original idea, never seen in space. And something that anybody did that, so why not? Maybe we can create something new and very useful.
But you still rely on magnetorquers for?
No, anything of that, any. Yeah, the common way is use magnetometer, electromagnet, and apply current in there to try to reorient the spacecraft. Okay. And also with the reaction wheels, you create momentum. For instance, the satellite is banking, and you turn on the reaction wheel in the opposite direction to stop that momentum. Okay. We want to do that with a pulsing mechanism, pushing to in space in order to stop that momentum. Yeah, this could be a revolutionary idea. We hope for the best. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, really interesting.
Sorry, I got long. Sorry.